All right, well, welcome back to the Nub. We're just going to keep screwing around with this until we get it correct. Yeah. This is the Merce.
This is Felton.
And we're going to talk about cookies.
Yeah.
Drop cookies.
Yep, I'm going to talk about my new peanut butter recipe.
Oh, yeah?
It's gluten-free, dairy-free, grain-free. It's actually food-free.
Oh, so
basically, it's just you look at a tray with the wax paper over it and pretend that there's a cookie there. Kind of like in Hook and Robin Williams.
Yes, and you have to pretend that you're eating it?
Yeah.
So,
it's really good.
Yeah, so that sounds pretty fantastic, actually.
Yeah.
I think, actually, because it is, like, the holidays, we should spend this entire time talking like those two ladies from SNL when they did the sweaty balls thing. And it's like, hi, this is the Merce, and today we'll be giving you the recipe for sweaty balls. You know what I'm talking about? With Alec
Vaguely.
Baldwin?
Yeah. Vaguely.
Oh, man.
They did so many, like, PBS fake show skits, though. And they were all great. I love that type of humor.
They were pretty fantastic. I gotta take these glasses off, though. I think they're actually affecting my ability to podcast right now.
Well, it's affecting your ability to not report on important issues.
So, did you see the trailer for the new Spider-Man movie coming out?
Yes.
Homecoming?
Yes.
Thoughts?
I can't wait.
See, I'm really not that excited by the trailer. Like,
really?
I watched it three times now, trying to get kind of pumped up for it. But I think they purposely have left out as much as they can.
Good.
To make it so that when you see the movie, God, you're going to be blown away. I will say that I love the bank robbery scene where he's talking about how, oh, you guys are the Avengers? The guy, you know, Hulk gives it away, you know? That was funny.
I'm wondering if the Rhino is going to be in it.
I think they're going to do the Sinister Six because that they're doing multiple villains. So.
Yeah, there's a scene in there. Now, they kind of did this with Paul Giovanni?
I'm going to let you go with that one.
Paul Giamatti? And the other Spider-Man,
yes.
Right? They ended it with him as the Rhino, but there was a guy in like a gray mech suit or something, and I thought, well, are they doing that? Are they doing the Rhino? Like, is this really happening?
I think they might do this.
I don't know why I sound like an old meemaw. Hello? You need to go eat your vegetables.
Did you get the milk and put it in the fridge?
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about it. I mean, I'm excited about it because I know that it's going to be good just because Marvel's just been killing it. And I know that that guy, the kid that's playing Spider-Man,
yes,
was fantastic in Civil War.
I enjoyed
so
him.
I'm just really looking forward to seeing him.
I like the style choice of having the eyes move. I think it worked in Deadpool, and they're like, we got to do that. No longer should Spider-Man have lifeless eyes.
Yeah. Yeah, they don't want their Spider-Man to be like a Vegas hooker, you know? They want her.
Yeah, that's stolid. Stolid?
Sure, we'll go with that.
What word is stoic?
Holy stoic.
Shit. Stoic face with no expression. Yeah.
But yeah, I'm pretty excited about that. I see that the patch dropped for Overwatch. I'm actually watching your girlfriend play right now.
Yes, Symmetra?
What is with you today?
Symmetra. They dropped her update, so it's live, so you can now project shields forth into the fight.
Wait, what?
Yeah,
you
didn't see that?
No.
Her update, you can now project a Reinhardt shield, and it just moves forward.
Oh my god.
Her turret's completely reset, so you start off with 6. She no longer projects shield barriers.
Okay.
But she has 2 ultimates now.
Is she still placed under a healer? Because she's really not a healer.
No, she's support, but she's actually like kind of a real support now.
Okay.
Because she was terrible before. Just about the only thing she could do would run circles around a Roadhog and kill him.
Let me tell
you,
so
slow.
My new favorite character to play right now is Zenyatta. I know I'm probably late to the party on that one, but my god, am I just having a blast with Zenyatta.
He is essential to kill the high HP enemies.
Yeah, well, I was watching this video, actually. Have you seen this? Have you seen this out there? Have you seen this? No. They're doing this new meta where it's all tanks.
Mm-hmm.
It's like or at least a 3-tank meta.
Yes. Oh my god, everyone's been talking about it. And they're so excited about it.
I don't understand why they're so, I mean, I understand how it works. I've
sure.
Seen it.
But
I've been waffle
there stuff. Have been celebrations though.
In the streets, yeah.
Like I've seen people the 3-tank meta.
Well, that's what happened. Like I woke up like Ebenezer Scrooge style, like at the end of the movie, and I opened my windows, you know, with my little nightcap on, and I was like, boy, why is everyone running through the streets? And he's like, haven't you heard, sir? Haven't you heard? There's a 3-tank meta! I was like,
But this is Pompeii. Everyone plays Xbox.
And I threw him a nickel and I asked him to go get me a goose.
Yeah, and he came back with a dime bag. No, he obviously misunderstood.
He never came back.
Wow. Yeah.
But, yeah, like, so, I don't know. I'm going to try it out, actually. I want to get with a couple of friends and, like, let's do this, you know, because I'm really enjoying playing with Roadhog, too, because I've not been good with any tanks lately, but for some reason, I had a buddy over last weekend. I was showing, you know, I was sick, you know, about showing him, you know, hey, you know, here's Overwatch, go buy it so we can play it online, you know, that kind of thing. You know, I'm basically become like a crack dealer for Overwatch. I'm like, I want you to buy it so I can play with you.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, you know, I was going through the different classes, and I played one from each class. And, of course, all the other classes I do great with, but I suck with the tanks, or so I thought. But I guess because I've been playing so much, I've learned the strategies. I picked up that Roadhog, and, I mean, I was just destroying
it. Get that hook. You know, here's my issue with Roadhog, right? He is essentially a tank McCree.
Yes.
Okay, you grab somebody, you stun them for the length of time that you bring them back.
Yeah.
And you shoot him immediately.
Yeah.
Now, there are certain characters who arguably have an advantage over him, like, was it Ana? Mm-hmm. Always is, like, 2 inches farther, and she is never a one-shot kill.
Yeah.
You know, so there are some characters who kind of have an unfair advantage. I just dropped something on the floor.
This is my fault.
Okay. So, yeah, Ana has that unfair advantage.
Yeah.
But basically, they went through all that rigmarole over nerfing McCree because he could kill Roadhog. Oh, should Roadhog. Look at that. Boom, boom, boom. Fan the hammer.
Yeah.
Reload, fan the hammer, right? Mm-hmm. Yet, Roadhog himself is just a really high HP McCree.
Yeah, well, in the word, he's a one shot kill for a lot of characters, you know? Like, when I'm playing Zenyatta, he's my worst enemy, you know? Like,
yeah.
I throw my Discord orb and run away, you know? Well, I mean, float very slowly away.
Yeah, but I mean, if you got more than one person, though, attacking him,
yeah,
you're good to go. Exactly. G2G, as the cool kids say.
I don't know any cool kids. I think it's the problem.
Yeah.
I pretend to. There's a movie coming out this week. I don't know. It's getting a little bit of hype, a little bit of
Rouge Uno?
Something about, like, I think an X-Men character got her own movie or something?
Backstabber.
Rogue? Didn't Rogue get her own movie? Or is this, like, a D&D
Backstabber
movie?
One.
No, yeah, so the new Star Wars movie is coming out.
Yeah.
Are we going to go on another mandate?
Yeah.
Go see that movie? Do you want to try to do, like, a Thursday night thing? Or do you work Thursday night?
I shouldn't.
Like, it'll be, like, a late premiere thing, you know?
Oh, you know what? I got off. I have a doctor's appointment. Now we'll go into HealthCast.
Yeah, tell me about the...
I have a doctor's appointment. No, I'm sorry. That's next Thursday. No, this Thursday I get off at 2. Yeah, so Friday I'm off regular time.
So, I don't know what a Bothan looks like.
Yeah, but are we going to find...
I want to know an actual number of how many Bothans actually died in the procurement of this secret... Yeah. You know, information that they got that basically said, hey, there's an exhaust port there, so we can just blow it up.
Yeah, hey, that big thing over there, the port, you know? Yeah.
With the exhaust?
You know, the thing that is about the same size of the stuff that Luke has been shooting all these years.
Are they Womp Rats or something?
Yeah, yeah. It's about the size of a Womp Rat. Look at the planning that George Lucas put into that by allowing, and I'm stealing this directly from one of these fan theory videos, right? Okay. There's one channel, The Lighter Side of the Force, and there was this one they're talking about, oh, well, how come Obi-Wan didn't train Luke his whole life? Like, what a waste that was.
Yeah.
And I guess the reasoning was kind of, you know, let him come to the Force.
Yeah.
You know, but he also had experience for, you know, being a really good sharpshooter and all these things that he learned through his life experience.
Well, Tatooine is no picnic. Like,
no, exactly. On Tatooine.
That's where Anakin came from, right?
Yeah. So
Anakin became a badass, right? He was spending time on Tatooine. So I'm sure that when Obi-Wan got him back to Tatooine, he was like, all right, just run
Tatooine
free.
It's like downtown Melbourne.
Tatooine will teach you.
Earlier tonight, there was a robbery at the mall. Yeah. So
Tatooine is the Melbourne Square Mall of the Star
galaxy.
Wars, yeah.
Mythos. But, yeah, so, yeah, Tatooine's a pretty bad shithole.
Okay, where the hell is Jakku? Is Jakku on the same planet as Tatooine, or...?
They were in warp for a while, though, weren't they?
They were what?
They were in warp when they were leaving Jakku or that shithole. They were, like, in warp drive for a while. Before
what
they got snatched up by that...
Yeah, but what I'm saying, like, Tatooine and Jakku look exactly the same to me. Is that the same planet?
No.
Or it's two different planets?
Two different planets.
I mean, I know that it's like a desert planet. You know, I get that. But it's like it's the same exact desert planet.
Though. Look
like,
at Mars, though.
I know, but couldn't... But Mars is red, is it not? Like, a good portion of Mars is red, right?
Sure.
Kind of. Like, so why couldn't they... I mean, we've got, like... I mean, I know that LucasArts and Disney have some money.
Yeah.
Like, couldn't we have made it, like, a green desert? Or, like, well, a red desert?
Now,
or
a purple desert? To play the devil's advocate here...
Okay.
Where on Earth...
Is Carmen Sandiego?
Is Carmen San... Actually, I know the answer to that question. Mm-hmm. She's retired, living in, like, California or something.
Hanging out with Waldo?
Yeah. No, actually, the actress Carmen Sandiego was actually an actress in the show.
Mm-hmm.
And I watched this whole, like, half-hour
expose. You really kind of weird me out here that you've actually tracked down the woman who played Carmen Sandiego.
Somebody else did, and I just read the story about it.
Oh, okay. Well, at least it wasn't you. Then
it was just one of these fucking clickbait articles that ended up across my news feed.
Is that a clipping of her hair that you have hanging from your wall there? Is that Is that that's another actress?
Okay. Yeah, same thing. That wasn't baby wipes in the picture you saw.
Yes. Okay, so I'm going to post it actually on the Nub later because it just really weirded me out. So I was running late tonight for the Nub podcast and Felton and I, we like to send each other just weird random shit when we text each other. I mean, imagine that with the way that we talk and act on the podcast. I'm sure
real life. Winning.
Yeah, she was knocking him down. Elise was just killing him in the old Overwatch. So he sends me this picture like your chair is waiting, and I look at it, I was like, all right, cool. But then I look a little closer, and it's like I had to look very closely because it's actually pretty. It's in the foreground. There's a setup of baby wipes with it open with the baby wipe ready to go, and he's like,
I flared.
Yeah,
that
it
out.
Was. Yeah, it was, I felt like it was like an advertisement actually for the an advertisement.
Paul Giamatti.
But for the actual baby wipes themselves, and I'm like, okay, first off, thank you, I appreciate that because I always do like to wipe up after the show, because I get very sweaty when I do the podcast. And for some strange reason. And secondly, how weird. But then I realized that, you know, that's not even the worst thing that we've sent each other. So Speaking of the worst things that people have sent each other, a friend of mine, in quotes, big time quotes, because I have a lot of quote unquote friends that are actually more like acquaintances.
Yeah.
Sent me a notice in it sent me a GIF or GIF. Do you say GIF or GIF? Either. I say GIF.
I say whatever.
I say Jiffy. Send me a good old Jiffy in the old Messenger for Facebook.
Yeah.
And I went to open it while I had my girl's family with me in the truck.
Oh.
Because I was, you know, kind of waiting, you know, we were waiting on something.
That's a good idea.
We're parked, you know, and I was, well, again, you know, I should know better because of the people that I talk to and the people I hang out with. So it turns out that it was a woman in a Santa costume with ginormous intuitions.
Yep.
Ginormous inhibitions, who then pulls open her Santa outfit to reveal her inhibitions.
Mm-hmm.
And here I am, you know, with grandma, you know,
yeah,
her brother, and her uncle, who I just picked up from the airport in the truck. And I'm like, oh, what the? First off, I'm really not that guy. Like, I'm not that guy that you send that kind of stuff to.
You can't wait for your next picture, pornographic image.
Yeah,
know?
Exactly.
Like, you can't even.
Like, if you're going to send me, if you're going to send me some kind of dirty picture, I'd rather it be like something just really messed up, like two midgets riding a donkey naked, you know, while having pudding thrown at them, or something like
in
that.
Bangladesh.
Something like in Bangladesh, yeah, something that just maybe has a little more meaning to it, a little more effort. You know, but just some woman just randomly exposing her breasts. I mean, that's
weird, though.
Yeah, it's
I've never,
especially when a straight guy sends that to another straight guy.
I've never felt compelled to be like, bro, check this out, and like take a picture of a porno or you know, a catalog magazine.
I think the problem is that we're not bro culture enough, is what it is.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, we don't, and it's funny because, you know, I was a firefighter, and you do something that's a really manly job as well.
Sure,
you know. Well, I mean, so a lot of the guys that do your job are manly.
Yeah.
You know, you yourself,
not
so much.
Let's
quantify
that. Hold on, yeah.
You yourself, not so much. But
I make costumes and video
exactly,
games.
Well, that's the thing. It's like I feel sometimes like we're incognito nerds, like incognerdo, you know? Like
I shoot guns.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I mean, that, and I own guns and I shoot guns, you know, exactly. And I have a, you know, I have a pickup truck, you know, like things like that. You know, I have some very, you know, manly esque.
I have a Nissan. Sensible.
Yeah. See again. But I think we're incognito is what it is sometimes, you know. But anyways, so in the future, just anybody that's listening out there that wants to send me some kind of, you know, inappropriate picture or GIF or GIF or meme or anything.
Santa that when he's a woman and
naked and exposing herself. Please make it at least artful, tasteful, or just plain weird. You know, don't just send me like run of the mill porn. You know, don't send me just regular, you know, regular boob showing, you know, stuff. Send me something that's gonna really like be provocative. Something I'm gonna want to show my friends. Like, oh my god, look at this! This woman has a praying mantis head on. You know, and she's, you know, riding, you know, a dragon.
Like for example, I got a picture one time from a friend, and it was it was a picture of this was a long time ago. You've probably seen it. It's a lady, and she's got her body painted as Predator.
Okay,
but she has a Predator mask on.
Okay.
Then the caption on it was "sexual predator."
See, I have seen that.
That is a visual pun. That is great. Fucking hilarious.
And that is fantastic. That's what I want. I don't want naughty Santa. You know, like,
but the visual pun, sexual predator. Please, that's send hilarious. That stuff.
Exactly.
Because then you look at it, your brain processes it, you understand it, and you laugh.
Or things that are like teetering on the edge of just. I mean, I can get arrested by the FBI if they saw it on my phone. Like, send me that kind of stuff. You know what I mean? Like, but don't send me just your run-of-the-mill
crap.
Like the
video of Saddam Hussein getting hung, but, like, the complete video where he's getting fucked by midgets afterwards.
Yes, exactly.
Like, his corpse is
that's
getting,
what I'm
like,
saying.
Railed.
That's what I want.
Yeah.
All right, so we've gotten far. Way off track here.
That's too far. All
right, let's really
so on the
in.
Topic of Star Wars, like, yes. where we started, somehow Jakku being a shithole and Tatooine being a shithole launched this.
Again, though, why? So it's not the same planet, though.
No, it's not. Okay, it's not the same planet.
Because I thought maybe Jakku was like a suburb on Tatooine.
Maybe,
like it's like there was a if you went around the other half of Tatooine, that's where like Luke grew up.
Pretty nasty fight that happened there. Fucking crashed Star Destroyers and shit.
Yeah.
So news about Rogue One.
Yes. I hear there's gonna be a bunch of both ends that die.
This made me laugh, and when I read the story, I said,
spoiler about the both ends, by the way.
Yeah. I said, good? So, the title of the article was, Neo-Nazis Want to Crush Rogue One at the Box Office with One Swift Boycott. And I thought, so there's like 1,000 people.
And they're all going to go to the one boycott? That's great. They get knocked out of the way.
That's less money than they're going to lose to pirating.
Should I point out the obvious? That basically, let me just point this out real quick. Rogue One is the story of the rebels, trying to get the secret plans to the Death Star that are run by the Empire, which has been proven to be the Nazi Party.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I get why the neo Nazis are upset about this.
No, they're
it's
upset.
It's very anti neo Nazi.
No, it's also because the last movie had the undertones of an interracial relationship.
Oh, yes, even though nothing actually happened.
Yeah, which at this point I'm like, oh,
well, they're
going to
be really upset because there is a lot of the theories that there's going to be an interracial homosexual relationship between Finn and Poe, which I don't think is going to happen. I don't think they'll touch on any actual sexuality in general, but
I'm
love Poe. Poe is my favorite character in there. Yeah. And if he turned out to be gay, I'd love him even more. Like, well, it's like my kid. If he turns out to be gay, I love him more. No,
I'm all about now that I've seen this. Yeah, oh yeah. Absolutely. Now that I've seen this, I'm like, oh god, they need to hook him up now. They need to ship that.
They do.
Because oh my god, just to piss in their face.
I just want
to
see that. I want to see their heads actually explode when they find this out. Like,
yeah, they're like, oh my god,
now,
no!
If they're going to boycott the movie, right, they're going to boycott, so they're not going.
Yeah,
right?
they're
basically
not
what
go.
A boycott is.
Neo-Nazis, you know? White supremacists.
They're not
going to
go.
So all like 5,000 of them, because there's probably like the research I've done for papers.
Can I ask how many neo-Nazis are known to be big Star Wars fans?
Like, oh, I have no idea.
Like, that would be an interesting
study to do. On the high count, you're losing 6,000 customers.
That's, but But were we losing 6,000 customers? No. Like, did they go to the other movies?
They weren't
going
to go to the movies anyway.
Yeah.
Because there's a good chance they don't live in a reasonable distance to a theater, mm-hmm. because they're out in the fucking tri-state area in the Midwest on their crazy people compounds,
yeah.
trying to fight the government.
Yeah.
And, oh, I'm going to get shot for calling.
Probably, because there's probably some neo-Nazis listening right now. Yeah. I think we just lost, we just lost our version of 5,000 neo-Nazis. Yeah. They started boycotting our show, so one person stopped listening.
They're not going to vote for us.
Well,
for
one person that never listened stopped listening.
Yeah. They're not going to vote for us for president. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Would you?
What? Stop.
So, all right. So neo-Nazis are boycotting the Star Wars movie. So,
and I think that's great.
I think honestly, I really think that's going to be what keeps this movie from becoming a box office blockbuster. Like
a box office success.
Yeah. Like honestly, that killed it. That's like when those crazy church people say that they're going
Westboro
to
Baptist
yes, thank
church.
You. When they say they're going to
you
boycott
know, they came
something,
to,
or...
they came to my town one time for work, for and work. There was like two of them. They were boycotting a school.
Yeah.
And
wait, two of them were boycotting a school. Yeah. How many of them actually go to school though?
No. Okay. They came down specifically for it.
Not to boycott, but to protest.
To protest.
Okay,
yeah,
as you say.
Protest school. Yeah, what the hell? Yeah,
I really don't think many of them go to school. That would be...
Yeah,
that's
have
a
their own school.
Yeah.
But I just thought that was the funniest thing. I'm mm-hmm. like, oh, that's like when Anonymous ever stages protests.
Mm-hmm.
The last time they did it in my city...
How can Anonymous stage a protest? You're not supposed to know who they are.
So. Yeah. So it was funny. There was like one guy that mm-hmm. showed up, and he was really upset. Like, oh man, this fucking sucks. So he had his little
But there was a bunch of other people that were there. There was a bunch of other people that were there, and they were laughing because they're just like, "You idiot! You don't understand how this whole thing works. We're anonymous."
Yeah, we're just here. They're like incognito. Mm-hmm. Like nobody knows.
Exactly. Just looks like a bunch of soccer moms hanging outside of a Costco.
So we had that. We have the Doctor Who trailer for the premiere.
For the Christmas episode,
special,
right? Yes.
Yep.
Very
and exciting. they also well, they kind of did a whole like season, Doctor Who thing.
Now
and,
somebody, not to get too far off,
yeah.
Somebody tried to convince me that they were in talks with the gentleman from Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them to be mm-hmm. the next Doctor. I
okay.
call shenanigans
mm-hmm.
because he's going to be busy making money big time as.
New Commander.
New Commander, probably doing another two movies, if not more,
Yeah.
So I was like, that would be awesome. It'd be interesting, but I don't think it's going to happen.
Well, you see, here's the thing. Look at the difference between Peter Capaldi and
all
Matt
the other doctors? Okay.
And Matt Smith. Matt Smith and David Tennant. Mm-hmm. David Tennant's a handsome guy, and I'm not saying that Matt Smith grew on me, but he's kind of a peculiar man, mm-hmm. you know? Handsome guy, still he grew on me. I think he's a handsome guy.
Well, here's the thing: you're not gonna have Newt Scamander as the Doctor. He's gonna have to make up his own persona.
But that's my issue, though, is he almost falls along the same vein of saying, "Oh, Benedict Cumberbatch needs to be." No, you don't need Benedict Cumberbatch to do everything.
Yeah.
No, you don't. You don't need him to do everything. Mm-hmm. I still say Richard Iodé, right from the IT Crowd,
mm-hmm.
and the Mighty Boosh. Oh my god, I
could see that.
Love
I would watch that.
Because his humor is that dry, and his deep voice. Oh god,
he would be
so great.
I still think they should approach Eddie Izzard.
Eddie Izzard?
Would be
phenomenal. Oh my god.
Especially if he did it in drag.
Wow. No.
You don't like drag?
That would be hilarious. She apparently doesn't like
it. She doesn't like it, but I like that idea. If he did it in drag the whole time,
yeah.
that would be amazing. I think that would be great.
That would be hilarious.
That would be revolutionary.
His comedy specials, and I remember watching him, in like the late early 2000s?
Something like that.
He
had
like the one with cake or death joke on the airplane. Oh my
cake
god.
Cake or death.
But that's the thing I think also
cake?
Too is, that's, that
no,
was
no, no,
in...
no, no,
no,
no,
no,
no,
no,
no, I want the cake.
Want the
no,
cake.
No, you said death.
No, you said death.
All right.
I'll give him death. But it's like this infliction, the way he has his voice.
Yes.
And I think what he did was important for many reasons because...
Oops.
Whoa. What?
I just made noise.
Oh. We have dogs barking, bones chewing, opening the can of rock stars. I'm going to do nothing. But you make that comedy special, he's in drag, he's telling jokes, he's funny.
Yes.
I think what he did is he probably is one of the people who heralded making, you know, these I don't want to say divergent and get the wrong connotation.
Yeah.
But, you know, these other lifestyles socially acceptable.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think he definitely made a lot of social change.
I mean, there's plenty of people well before him, you know.
Sure.
But I think that he was one of those people that you could say was probably a trendsetter in that, yeah. in that regard, where,
well, look at what happened
became,
to Ellen.
It became extremely, well, Ellen was a huge,
huge comedian, and well, she comes out, she's gay. Her show got canceled.
Yes, her show was one of the top shows of its time, and it got canceled after she came out saying she was gay.
Yeah.
And all that did was fuel, you know, a movement that really, you know, helped a lot of gay people in the world. So I think that's one of the bravest people probably on Earth. I really think that she deserves, pardon me, some kind of, oh my God, think about Ellen as the doctor. That would be interesting. She only wants to dance and shit.
All right.
After they... No, I couldn't actually see that, but man, that would be interesting.
Why not?
But
I could hook her up with the new
the master?
The master.
Yeah, the new master, yeah. But I really think ship him.
Let's do it.
I really think that she should get something like a Nobel Prize or something like that.
Didn't she get some award from Obama?
I'm sure she did, but I mean, something that's recognized by more than just, you know,
Obama.
But, well, I mean,
he gave, right? Just imagine, like, these things he comes out are just like these construction paper, like, with gold stars on them. Like, this is the Obama award.
Well, you did a good job. Thank you for your time.
You anything official, so I made this.
This is called the Obama Award. It's me and the girls, we sat down with some glitter glue and some sticky stars, and you know, I think we worked hard on this.
we should make a store, right? Mm-hmm. The Nub store.
Yes.
And then that could be one of the things that we sell. Obama awards. We can have them as stickers.
Man.
Construction paper, crappy gift.
So where were we? We're starting Doctor Who.
Doctor Who. And there is some type of fucking superhero man in the trailer. I don't know what this episode is going to be, if this is going to be like one of those episodes with like the Sandman or, you know, some weird shit, but there's a guy like straight up rubber superhero outfit flying around like Superman.
I can dig it.
And in my notes I wrote, what the fuck, superhero man?
It's like, not Capaldi?
No. Yeah, but, that's funny.
I'm interested to see that.
Oh.
Yes.
Have you seen... No. And it's back.
Okay, so we had a dog-related incident. I have no idea what we're talking about right now.
I was complaining about Doctor Who.
Well, then continue, please.
And the superhero man.
Mm-hmm.
And, that was basically it. I didn't really... Wow. Dog-related licking. I had to get myself a delicious Crystal Light also.
Yes, so. I understand that. I understand that need. It's just the need.
Oh, it tastes so good.
So good. I like the Ghostbusters cup it's in, too. The ginormous,
ginormous big... half of Kate McKenna's head.
Yes, absolutely.
I love Kate McKenna. She's great.
Who doesn't? All right. So
as I believe before the DRI, Dog Related Incident, asked you if you had seen the Iron... Did you saw it?
Did I saw what?
Did you saw it? The Iron Fist trailer?
No. The Iron Fist, right?
Iron Fist.
Okay, not the Iron Fish. Yeah, that would be a totally different movie.
The Iron Fist.
It just kind of sits at the bottom of the ocean. It can't go anywhere.
It just, it kind of flops on one side on the bottom. It's kind of really sad. One of those tear jerkers. It makes your eyes sweat a little bit.
No, I didn't. How was it?
Netflix. Netflix series.
Yes, I know what it is, but how was the trailer?
It looks pretty good. Interesting. I have no idea. I just know that there was a character named the Iron Fist.
Yes.
That is the extent of my knowledge.
He's another Hell's Kitchen superhero.
Okay, so he just...
Hell's Kitchen honestly must have, like, the worst crime rate in all the world.
I think the bigger question is, what is wrong with Hell's Kitchen to where it's so unsafe that you can't, like, go anywhere without getting turned into some superhero because of some mutagenic compound or something?
Well, here's the thing. The man who is Iron Man is Danny...
DeVito?
No. I almost said Danny Trejo as well, but it's Danny something or another. I don't remember what his last name is. But he actually gets his power from, like, you know, like a real, like, mystical force, right? So he doesn't get that in Hell's Kitchen. So he left Hell's Kitchen, gets this crazy mystical force, and then returns to Hell's Kitchen.
You know who else? Batman.
You know who else did the same thing?
Batman.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, and Christopher Nolan's he did.
Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
Doctor Strange gets the crazy mystical powers.
Is it the same? Is it Marvel?
Yeah.
So they're going to be hanging out with each other.
They're all just going to be chilling in Hell's Kitchen. Just
yeah.
Hanging out, like swapping stories. Like, you know, I want to see the episode that's directed by Kevin Smith, where they're just all kind of sitting there talking. Because he said once if he directed a superhero movie, this is what he would do. The heroes would be kind of, you know, talking to each other, like lean up against like a car or something like that, or, you know, some, you know, building or something related to that superhero franchise, you know, they'd be talking about something like, you know, whatever, pussy or whatever the case would be, is, you know, then off camera, there would be some kind of bank robbery or fight or something like that. And they'd be, oh, let's go stop that real quick. They would go off camera. You wouldn't see anything. You just hear the noises and stuff. And they get back and, you know, they're like, dust themselves off. It's like, what were we talking about again? Oh yeah, that's right. You know, whatever it was, pussy or whatever the case would be, is, you know? So I really want to see Kevin Smith direct an episode of one of these shows where it's like Doctor Strange,
Zero
Luke Cage, Iron Fist, Daredevil, Punisher, and Jessica Jones, and they're all just like right outside the Sanctum Sanctorum or whatever it is, and they're BSing like, hey, you know, do you see what happened to She-Hulk? Like, you know, like she, like her dress totally ripped open, like in front of everybody at court, you know, and, you know, everybody saw her big green breasts or whatever the case may be. And all of a sudden, oh, well, is that Dr. Doom, for whatever reason, Hell's Kitchen causing a ruckus? They all go off scene. You hear the, oh, yeah, blah, 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 you know, all the fighting, the crashing and stuff like that. And they come back and they kind of dust themselves off. And it's like, well, we're talking about, oh, yeah, that's right, big green breasts. You know what I mean? Like, I would love to see.
Use the eye of Agatha Christie to turn back time.
Yes. If I could turn. I honestly think that he should have, like, a little iPad. And when he does that, when he uses that, he plays songs that are related to time.
Tyler.
Like, if I could spend time in a bottle, you know, like every time he's.
No, save time in a bottle.
Is it save time?
No, yeah, I don't think it's spend time in a bottle.
I'm not going to argue with you because I'm always wrong with these things. So.
Save time in a bottle.
That makes a lot more sense, actually. I was like, why would you spend time in a bottle? Now it all makes a heck of a lot more sense. But if they played that one, there might be issues because Sony actually still owns rights to Quicksilver. If, you know, for Quicksilver to come running through that scene, there might be financial issues.
If you were a little seaman on a boat, on a little one of those ship bottles.
I like where this is going.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you were a little seafaring man.
Hold on, this podcast is a little more inappropriate than we normally do.
No. Okay, a man of the sea.
Oh, a man of the sea. Okay, because I'm thinking a bunch of sperm on a really small boat.
On the boats in the bottle, yes. If you were a tiny little man,
yes,
then you would be spending time in a bottle.
That would make sense.
Yeah.
Or if you were actual semen on a small boat in a bottle.
I'm sure there are some rich men that do that. They make the boat and then.
I don't think you have to be rich for that. I think you just have to be really disturbed.
I always associate those little bottle ships with Richmond.
Yeah.
Because who else has the time?
I am Zachary Richmond.
I have five homes in the
Tri-State area.
Vineyards. Agatha Christie's Vineyards.
Yes.
Everything is Agatha Christie's
town. I see that. Got my Game Informer magazine. Well, I should. Okay, let me backtrack a little bit.
Are you informed?
This is probably two Game Informer magazines back because I'm really backlogged on my magazines. But I was reading
about.
You don't
poop enough.
Huh? I don't. That's a problem, actually. Like, now since I've changed my diet, we're not going to get into that, though. We're not turning this into the health,
health cast again.
So, I was reading about the Mass Effect Andromeda, the new. Mass Effect game coming out, which has nothing to do with Colonel Shepard or whatever he was at the end of the series, whatever the canon is, right? But it actually takes place at the the beginning of this game takes place apparently halfway through the second game, and what it is before everybody knows about the Reapers, you know, for sure, and that all these things are happening. They get three of the big races together, the humans, the Turians, and whatever the ones with the cool octopus head together.
The Ood?
No. Although I like the Ood. The Ood would crack me up. And they get these like ginormous ships and they send them out to explore another part of the galaxy that has not been explored yet, and their whole mission is kind of Star Trek-y, because they're going where no man has gone before to kind of, like, set up settlements and stuff. And that's where this game is taking place. And you get to choose you know, the male or female character, they're twins, all right? They have nothing to do with Colonel Shepard or anything like that, but it's
human. Oh, so that's how they're getting around it this time. Yeah,
but they're humans again, which kind of annoys me, because I'm like, I really wanted to be able to play, like, a Torian or the cool octopus head people, or...
No, it's not like an octopus head, though, right?
It's just, well, like, it's, they have flaps. It looks like some tentacles to me, but I don't
it's
know.
It's just flaps, right?
I really want to see them get upset, and all of a sudden just, like, it just comes out like the spitter in Jurassic Park.
Or the snakes out of Beetlejuice's face.
Yes.
Or whatever the hell that was.
That'd be really great.
Never know.
Anyways, long story short, I'm really excited about this game. I'm really hoping that it keeps with the great things that they did with Mass Effect without giving you the crappy ending. I really hope that the ending of this will be good, because I'm sure it's going to be another, like, three games. You're going to be really enveloped in this, and you're going to be so like, oh my god, all my choices, all this, blah, 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 and you get to the end, and you're just like, really?
And it's just static ending, no differences. Yeah.
Like, really, after everything I did?
So, if you haven't beaten Mankind Divided now, and you want to hear the ending, you should skip the next 5 minutes.
I haven't even played it yet. So
okay.
Go ahead.
You're probably not going to.
Blow my mind with it.
So the way that they actually ended the game was there were actually a couple of cutscenes where, like, you're talking to one of the characters and discussing, like, oh, you saved the world. Yay. And then the ending of the game.
With that exact enthusiasm, yeah. Like, oh, you saved the world. Yay. So
the ending of the game is... You watch the news. And
that's a great FU ending. You know how much I love FU endings. Now I'm going to play that game because I want that FU ending.
So everything that you do, Eliza Kassan, the AI reporter for Pycus.
Yes.
In the first, did you play Deuce Human Revolution?
No.
Okay, so there's this news station called Pycus.
Yes.
And the head news anchor, like, delivers all the world news.
Mm-hmm.
And her name is Eliza Kassan. And she's actually a holographic AI that they made to be the face and say anything they wanted to say,
mm-hmm.
right? So a lot of stuff happens. She ends up getting her personality split, creates a rogue AI. So there's two, you know, the Eliza Kassan that has a moral existential crisis in the first game. You actually end up saving in this one. And she goes off and floats away into the Ethernet, I guess. I don't know. We'll find out. Because, oh, by the way, there really wasn't a fucking ending to the game. It just kind of went, oh, we still have to fight the Illuminati. And they leave it. It's like, oh, are you a secret bad guy or not? So it's like, what the hell's going on?
You get to choose your own ending.
Yeah, like, what is the next game going to be? We get to find out even more if you're a secret bad guy or not? Like, God, fuck, you know?
Secret agent, man.
So I'm a little upset that after all that, there were no conclusions to anything.
No.
And I actually stumbled on, like, a lot of stuff the developers put in as, like, little haha, I think just, like, Easter egg stuff.
Yeah.
Through reading and hacking and breaking into literally everyone's apartments in the game.
Like, we talked about this last podcast. Yeah. I love that stuff.
Yeah.
I'm a huge kleptomaniac.
You can break into a lot of places and steal all the beer.
All right.
Oh, there's all the beer.
I need all the beer.
Yeah.
I am down with that.
There's, it's funny. But that just, oh, that fuck, that irritated me. Just because I'm like, oh no, I wanted, but I mean, I guess I'm happy in the end because that means there's going to be another game.
Yeah.
And I do believe that this was a little bit better.
You can't look a gift game in the face.
Yeah.
Right? Gift horse
game. Gift game. I mean, it was better than... They improved over the last one. So, I can't complain. But I do still think that the way that they changed the skill system really... I still don't like.
Speaking of improvements, okay. I picked up the expansion for the board game Marvel Legendaries.
Okay.
And this one's Marvel Legendaries Civil War.
Okay.
And they've made a lot of cool improvements, but the thing that I really loved about it... And I don't know if they... I don't know. I guess it's just the way that I looked at it, but it was awesome that the game itself picks a side, you know? The game itself decided that one side was going to be evil and the other side was going to be good. You know what I'm talking about when I say Civil War, right? Like the whole Captain America versus Iron Man thing, right? So Iron Man and all his people are the bad guys, you know, and then Captain America and all his people are the good guys, you know? And I really thought it was interesting that the game didn't give you a choice to, like, switch that back and forth, but I thought it was kind of cool. Unless they're coming out with a second one, and it's flipped. They flipped the script, but that'll just be a money grab at that point in time.
So whose side is Black Widow on?
oh, Black Widow, if I remember from the actual comic books, because this is based off the comic books, Black Widow did everything she could to try to stay neutral.
Yeah.
I think she gets forced into being on Captain America's side.
Yeah.
Only because she was being neutral, that put her in a place where she really had
To be neutral, she had to be on his side.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, she really had no choice anymore because Tony Stark was like, no, there is no neutral. There's one side or the other. And it's like, well, if you won't let me even choose neutrality, then my choice is made.
Yeah. Right.
That kind of thing. And I think she did, like, a finger snap thing.
Probably.
And then did, like, 5 backflips out of the office. Then picked up coffee.
That seems reasonable.
Quick story. Well, not story. Maybe observation.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think I mentioned earlier that my girl's uncle came into town today, and I had to go to the airport in Orlando to pick him up, you know, that whole 9 yards, you know, with her family and that kind of thing. And, you know, never met the guy, never talked to him on the phone, nothing. But nerddom and being nerdy, like, bonded us pretty damn well. Like, we were talking for a majority of the day today just about different nerdy things. You know, like, he's into video games, I'm into video games. He's playing Battlefield 1, which I've really been heavily, you know, considering buying. You know, so we were, you know, talking about that. I was trying to sucker him into getting Overwatch because, again, I'm a Overwatch crack dealer. And I'm trying to get people to play Overwatch.
You have a trench coat and you walk around and you have copies of it.
Hey, you guys want some of this Overwatch?
Some more Blizzard Entertainment?
So yeah, like, we talked about animes, we talked about, you know, a bunch of that kind of stuff. And it just kind of dawned on me, again, the whole reason I started the Nerds United Brevard and all that stuff, the whole reason I've tried to make these friendships and build up friendships with these nerd stores and organizations in Brevard is because I want a very strong nerdy community. And I thought it was cool that this guy, her uncle, has spent a good portion of his time the past 2.5 years in Dubai. He's been there working, like, you know, government contract,
like,
kind of stuff.
Dubai, yeah.
Like not,
the tall building, like, place. Yeah, that turns the light off.
Whoops. Not like...
pull it again?
And there we go. Not like I can't, you know, say goodbye, you know, so I say Dubai. You know, no, it's actually...
Dubai. I have a rare bone disorder that doesn't allow me to say the B and
yeah.
Goodbye.
So...
The D and goodbye.
So I thought that was interesting. I thought it was cool. You know, it was just another one of those times where it's like, you know, we're kind of sitting in the truck, not really a whole lot to say, and then somehow.
So how about that Overwatch? Whoa!
Exactly. All of a sudden, it's like, oh my god, you're a nerd too, and we just kept, you know, going from there.
We got outed, and then it was going on from there.
Thank God he wasn't all into sports and stuff like that, because I would have just been like, oh, yeah,
how about man, that was great how they tossed the ball in that one sports game. Did you see the other sports game where the guy caught the ball real well?
I'm so glad that one team won. Yeah. You know, I feel bad for the other team that didn't win, though.
No, fuck them. What? Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah. Sports.
Yeah, I just thought that was interesting, you know? Hell, I mean, nowadays I seem to use my nerdiness for everything because one of my friends, you know, went through a breakup recently, a bad breakup, and he's over. As a matter of fact, you know, my last breakup is how I got playing Overwatch so much, you know. So then, you know, my buddy's, you know, going through his breakup, and me being me, you know, I don't do so well with the whole, like, emotions thing. Like, you know, you get the sweaty eyes and things like that. Like, I don't, you know, I have trouble with that. So, you know, I try to work my eyes out. It just doesn't happen. So... You know, he comes over, you know, we're having a couple beers and stuff like that. I'm, you know, he's talking about his thing, and I'm just like, you know, that sucks. Sorry.
I got some crybait for you then.
I don't know what to do. And then I'm just like, hey, have you played Overwatch? I set him down for that Overwatch, and I kid you not, by the end of the night, he's just like, oh my god, this is the greatest game ever.
Summer is my waifu.
Yeah, so.
Oh, I got some crybait for you then.
Go ahead, drop it on me.
This video that's going around.
Oh, is it the Santa video?
Yeah.
I'm going to watch it. Maybe I should film myself watching it. Maybe I should do a reactional video.
Yeah, you should do a reaction video and you sit there the whole time. You
know? And then when you guys see that I have no actual soul, did he just laugh? Is he laughing at the dead child?
Santa's got a hair in his nose.
To the listeners that may not know.
It's tragic. I mean, and the poor guy. He's a professional Santa, right?
How do you become a professional Santa?
He's got the rosy red cheeks, and he's got the mustache.
I mean, wow, that's like a year-round commitment, though.
He is, like, hardcore. Wow. This guy is a Santa, okay? And the Make-A-Wish granted this kid his wish that he wanted to see Santa, okay? And
if you ever get a call from the Make-A-Wish people, you really should just be like, I'm not home.
Man, I don't know if I can commit to that lifelong depression.
Yeah. Like,
That's gonna scar
as
my
soon
soul.
As soon as they're like, "Hi, this is Susan. I'm calling from Make-A-Wish." Like, oh, Susan, you got the wrong number, sweetie. I'm sorry. I don't know who you're trying to reach.
My name is not who you think I am. So
like,
anyway,
if the nub ever got a call from the Make-A-Wish Foundation, I would burn the whole thing down. I would delete all the accounts.
We're closed.
Yeah,
we're closed.
Something horrible is about to happen. I'm just not gonna be able to handle it.
So it's super sad. The kid.
I already have issues with emotions. Like I don't express them. Like, this is gonna push me over the edge, and then I'm gonna have sweaty eyes for the rest of my life.
You're
after
gonna
that.
Have
yeah.
you know 30 years of
repressed. Yeah, just
once. Oh my god, emotion vomit.
All right, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So yeah, the punchline is that, you know, they have this tragic conversation, and the kid ends up dying in the guy's arms. Like, after he, you know, they talk about their, you know, what this kid's wish is. And the poor guy, I mean...
Can I just interject for a second and really kind of give everybody an insight into how messed up I am? As soon as you said that the kid died in his arms, immediately after you said it, that 80s song came to mind. I just died in your arms tonight. It must have been something you said. That's how messed up I am. Like, I just don't, you know... Okay, so, sorry, go ahead.
So, yeah, it's super sad. So, I mean, I don't even think you can make through it.
I'm gonna get my phone out. I'm gonna film myself watching it and see what happens.
Poor Bash
can't handle it.
He watched it and he was like,
he's scarred for life. He didn't even used to be a dog before. He was a cat originally.
Yeah.
Poor guy.
He's a gerbil. So yeah, on that topic is kind of my main branch off into that. Mm-hmm. Is the all of these friggin' crybait videos. Mm-hmm. I don't understand it. Like, and especially, I cannot handle anything to do with dogs. Mm-hmm. I mean, in to a degree, cats, because they're like, you know, they're little assholes.
Yeah.
But I know they can be cute.
They're like really stuck up dogs.
They're the serial killers of the pet world.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be frank. They're predators.
Well, yeah, their way of saying, "Hey, I love you," is like, "Hey, you see this rat I brought you?
Hey, this TV that you're doing sit-ups under, yeah. I'm going to knock it off under your neck. I'm trying to kill you." Exactly. Yeah, that's a cat. But anything to do with dogs or pets or anything, I can't deal with it. I can't deal with it. And I suppose that's what somebody with kids would have, that reaction, you know?
I will say that I haven't always been... I was really heartless before I had my son, and I've become heartless again over the years. But when my son was first born...
Yeah.
Like, I really did go through a time where I could not watch anything that had anything to do with something horrible happening to kids.
Yeah.
I remember my ex-wife used to love to watch Criminal Minds.
Yeah.
You know? And there was one episode, all they showed was a little girl's shoe with, like, a drop of red on it. You know? A little girl's shoe with a drop of red on it. I was like, I lost it. I was like, I can't watch this stuff. What sick bastards. Oh, my God. Who writes this crap? Like, I sound like an 80-year-old man going on a rant about how TV today has become
nothing but rape and murder.
Yeah.
Oh, God. You know, what's his name? Jeff Goldblum actually had a show that happened
where he would just do that over and over
again?
Yeah.
No, it was kind of a good detective show. And the
last
episode...
Oh, my God. I can only imagine Jeff Goldblum as a detective. He's just like, so,
it was actually a really good show. I enjoyed it immensely.
I just picture him Dr. Malcolm X, well, Dr. Malcolm, sorry. No, he makes the joke about I'm always looking for the next X Miss Malcolm.
Yeah.
So I always picture him as Dr. Malcolm, you know? So I could imagine him as Dr. Malcolm, but as the detective.
It was a good show. The last episode, they dealt with a dead kid that got, like, total rape, murder, kill.
Yeah.
And they kind of did, like, the same thing. But the shtick with this show was he kind of had some medical thing, and his brain would, like, make him see the ghost.
Okay.
So...
I don't think that's medical.
Well, he wasn't actually seeing ghosts.
Oh, okay.
Or maybe he was. I don't know. So...
I'm pretty sure that most people in the medical field will tell you that that's hallucinations.
Yeah. He was having hallucinations.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the thing. They would help him solve the murder. And then when he solved the murder, they would go away.
Okay.
So, oh, and another thing, too. He had, like, OCD or some, like, issue that was causing him to have the... So, it was a really interesting show, but the...
So, it was like Monk meets... Dr. Malcolm from Jurassic Park
meets
Medium. Medium. Yeah, that's good. Yeah. I was gonna say Stir of Echoes, but yeah, that works.
Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Yeah,
yeah.
Like the three of them just kind of meshed together into one
long time running show that she had.
It's like, okay, so here's the thing: we like detective shows, we like medium ghost like shows, And we like bumbling idiot-esque, you know, Columbo shows with like a just a little hint of a mental disorder, like OCD. What do we need? Like,
let's get Jeff Goldblum. Because he is a peculiar, wonderful man. Yeah.
Him. Although, did you ever see? I think it was Mr. Frost or something like that. It was about like the first known or first documented, well, the first actual captured serial killer.
Captured Mr. Freeze.
Yeah, no, the first captured.
He was a mob hitman.
No, it was the first captured serial killer in England. And I don't know. I think it was called Mr. Freeze or Mr. Frost or something like that. I have to look it up now.
He was a hitman.
He was not a hitman. He was just a crazy serial killer.
Really?
Yes. And when they arrested him, they found all the devices and stuff. And then it got weird because then it went into this whole because he started thinking he was the devil, and then he started getting people to hurt themselves.
I'm thinking of a guy.
But
who...
not once in that entire movie did he do the weird Jeff Goldblum like bumbling idiot thing. Like he was straight. Like he was almost to the point where you're just like, this is really disturbing, and it was great. It was fantastic. But it was a very low budget kind of thing. So.
Oh, Jeff Goldblum played the character of this film.
Hmm?
Jeff Goldblum was in it?
Yes, he was the main character.
Oh, okay. Was it based on a true story?
Yes. Okay. Hold on. The first half of it was, until it got into the whole weird, like, you know, I'm the devil kind of stuff, and then
I gotcha. I saw an interview with a guy who was a hitman, and he was talking about how he just will like beat the shit out of people and you know, do this stuff, and eventually got into.
By the way, it was Mr. Frost. It's a 1990 film.
It's actually
spelled out Mr. Frost.
Not to be confused with Jack Frost.
Yes, not Jack Frost or Mr. Freeze.
Which, by
like,
the
especially
way,
not Arnold's Mr. Freeze.
Does not.
Nice to meet you.
Does not hold up well, Jack Frost.
Well, neither does was that Batman Forever or whatever? Yeah, Batman and Robin. That's it. Batman and Robin with Arnold Schwarzenegger. Nice to meet you.
Let me get real close and just say this. Alicia Silverstone.
Everybody had nipples in that, including her. And then Arnold Schwarzenegger's Mr. Freeze outfit, for some reason, had these glass bubbles so you could see his pecs. Like, the rest of his body is encased in metal, and you've got these glass bubbles so you can see his pecs. Well, I'm sure because they were paying, like, probably, like, a million a pec, they were like, we're going to see those pecs. Like,
let's be real here. That was probably Arnold suggesting.
Probably.
Like, no, you see my pecs in the suit. How can you see that I've got really whipped and swole over the years?
I could imagine. I would love to have been a fly on the wall when he's in there with his agent and they're discussing his contract for this movie. He's like, no, I will not wear that costume.
I am
the
not
costume
going
needs
to say
to show my out. The costume needs to show my pecs. I work very hard on these pecs. I'm very enthusiastic about these pecs.
I get
and I have to say really cheesy out. Things. I have to say really cheesy things like, "Nice to meet you."
Oh God,
come with me if you want to leave. That then was, we can get to the chopper. I'll put all of it in.
That was a real conversation.
That probably was.
I think that happened.
And he was smoking a big old cigar at the same time and drinking brandy, but not from like a little sifter, but from like a giant.
Slapping his mate's butt as she's walking by. Getting random women pregnant. Oh, he only had one illegitimate child.
Well, that we know of.
Yeah.
We're waiting for the others to come out. Like,
did you ever see the infomercial he did about, or was it Lou Ferrigno?
I really wish that his illegitimate children got his syntax, his way of talking. Like that'd be the way that you know. Like if he's like the kid knocks on his door, he's like, I do not have another child. He's like, But father, look at me. Look at my pecs. He's like, oh my God, you're my child.
So that's how they identify each other. Schwarzenegger.
And they have the laughter, they're like, oh, it's really strange though when it's his daughter.
She's, yeah. Look at my pecs. Oh, God, that's unsettling. You have a man's body.
Gonna die on the podcast tonight.
It's terrible.
Where do we start with this?
Does he have a daughter?
I have no idea, but if he does, I'm sure she's
really... I bet she's wonderful. Yeah, I'm not talking nasty.
She's probably
about,
an angel.
Yes. I don't mean to talk nasty about a man who could rip my head off with his...
I'm not talking nasty about him. I'm not talking about nasty about a man who's influenced a good portion of my childhood, from Conan the Barbarian... You know, to Kindergarten Cop, to True Lies, to
Now let's talk about True Lies for a second, since we're off on this path.
Yeah,
that really
here comes the rabbit hole.
No, I'm just saying that really was a good action film.
I loved it.
That was a great action.
What's
movie.
Like Last Action Hero? I love. Yeah, I thought Last Action Hero was fantastic.
He had a good run there.
Yes.
Damn politics. Mm-hmm. He should have just made movies.
especially when, like, I was expecting, like, when he became governor, that he would be, like, so, like, you know, just Arnold as a governor, you know? But yeah. It turns out that, it turns out that the person you see in the movies isn't the actual person in real life.
He was, like, an intelligent politician.
Yeah, it's strange. He had his own views and his own, like, the policies and stuff he was putting in place. I was like, this is strange. I just want to get to the chocolate.
I mean, I don't know if they were good or bad.
I don't know either. I don't live in California, yeah. So.
But, I mean, you got to be somewhat smart to win and, you know, be a governor, I guess. Yeah. So, hey.
Well, I mean, I'm not going to go there.
Don't.
We're not going to get political right now. So, anyways. Hey, I see you guys were working on a puzzle recently.
Let's just say the state of Florida spends a lot of money trying to kill Harry Potter.
Did you see that meme I posted?
I think it was on
the Nerds United in regard where it was like, Voldemort is like a teenage girl.
Mm.
He keeps a diary. You know, he's really into jewelry.
Yeah.
He's really obsessed with a teenage boy. He's got a pet. Like,
yeah.
I thought that was hilarious.
That's true, though.
It is true. It is absolutely true.
And then just regular Johnny Depp at the end of Fantastic Beasts.
Oh, spoiler. Oh, how could you do that? He totally 21 Jump Street does, though.
Yeah.
That was ridiculous.
I said, what? Is that, what? What?
I didn't even know he was in the movie.
What?
Yeah, my girl's like, you didn't know? I'm like, no, I had no idea. Nobody told me.
I didn't care. I had no expectations.
Yeah.
I walked into that with no expectations.
That's why I like to do movies now. I don't want to know anything. Like, give me the, like, that's, I get, okay, so here I am. This is the double-edged sword of me, I guess, the catch-22. I just finished earlier complaining about how the Spider-Man trailer didn't really show anything.
Yeah.
You know, so it didn't get me really hyped up. Yeah. But then at the same time, like, I'd rather not know a whole lot, so when I go into the movie, the whole movie is, like, a whole experience for me. Like, from beginning to end, like, I had no idea this was going to happen. When it turned out that was Johnny Depp, I was like, oh my God, this is amazing.
Like, and then you're like, oh, it's just him with pale face and white hair.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was going to be. I thought that's all that Colin Farrell was turning into. It was like he was becoming an albino version.
Yeah, his hair was turning white. I really, legitimately was sitting there like, he's a Malfoy.
Can we talk for a minute about how absolutely creepy Johnny Depp looks as an albino?
Yeah.
Like, he was not looking good at all. Like, I consider Johnny Depp, you know, a very good-looking man, you know, and I'm just going to say it. Like, I was turned way off by that. I was like, whoa, like, that was not the Johnny Depp that I'm used to.
Now, is he going to be the main bad guy?
I guess, yeah.
That's
what the reveal was.
He was just, like, one-off, like, oh, okay.
And then go right back to Colin Farrell.
Kind of like the Joker, you know?
Yeah.
Like the Joker in Batman. I mean, for obvious reasons, they couldn't bring him back. But...
Oh, you mean Heath Ledger? Why, what happened? I didn't know. Was there an incident? Or... I heard he was on a mountain somewhere.
Oh, no.
At one point, no?
Yeah, mountain in... Oh, yeah, I see where you went with that.
No, I know. God, see, that's what I'm talking about. Maybe I need to talk to somebody about this.
You have a lot of repressed Heath Ledger emotion.
Brokeback Mankiss.
Never mind.
So anyways, yeah, so Johnny Depp, good albino, very scary.
Yeah. So we've got, I've been seeing on our other counties Facebook group that they're posted. Have you seen this? The Coscography?
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 What other county are you talking about?
No, the Space Coast Cosplay and Props.
Oh, okay.
The other county's Facebook page.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I guess. I don't know.
I have to follow them again, I guess, because I don't get their stuff in my feed. So, well, what's going on?
Am I missing? Apparently, and I'm getting, and this is just my assessment,
mm-hmm.
I think some of the participants of the Space Coast Comic Con are putting on kind of like a mini event on June 17th.
Okay.
Where it's just cosplay panels. At the Space Coast Convention Center.
I don't know if I'll be here then. I think that's dangerously close to like a MegaCon, Dice Tower, like
June?
All that stuff. Yeah, well, there's like May, June, July. There's a bunch of stuff going on.
Maybe it was January.
And then I know that September is the.
I put June, but I think it's actually January.
Yeah. Well, anyways, so June, what you said, 17th?
We'll say June or January 17th.
We'll definitely have to check that out because if we can, because I'd like to support, you know. Other cosplaying stuff, and you know, me just now starting to get into my cosplay stuff myself.
Maybe. No, I'm never gonna find it again.
Yeah, especially I think we're up against the
Yeah, we're running against the clock here.
Yep.
Running against the clock.
Running with the
wind. Well, anyway, if I find a link tonight or tomorrow when I upload this,
post it on the Nub for people to see.
I'll link it. Because it looked neat.
Well, that's the whole point of the Nub, too, is to broadcast that stuff, let people know what's coming up.
I'm really not making a good sales pitch. Like, I'm trying to get people excited to go. Hey, you know about this
thing that's coming up.
So I'm like, it's a thing.
Also, in January is the Renaissance Fair. But now the music is starting to come in, so I guess we can talk about this next time.
Talk about the Renaissance Fair next time.
I want to thank y'all for listening. I've been the Merce.
We felt them.
And we will talk to you at another date.
Yeah.
And sorry about last week.